But again, thank you for being there this weekend. We, you know, she told me in our conversation, Rebecca did this morning, she said, "Dad, I remember back just a few years ago when that thing was, you know, we always had it behind the church at the other building, and about the largest we could ever get that thing was about between 300 and 400 people. We just seemed to you know, kind of get landlocked because of our size. But I want you to know, for the last two years up here, this will be our third year doing it here. Last year we had over 1,200 people show up. It has multiplied and multiplied, and the community is accepted this as an event that we are giving to our community. We are giving out, and this is an opportunity for us to love our community. And there's going to be some neat things going on in this event. There are some evangelistical things that are going on as well. I know one of the booths that we're doing this year specifically is going to be making a bracelet, and I think Crystal is in charge of that. And the kids will come in, and they'll go through, and they'll take a group at a time, and there are different color beads that they will put on there. And some of you know the plan of salvation with the different colors, and you have the black, which represents sin, and then you have the red, which represents the blood, and then you have the white, which represents purity because of the blood, and then you have green, which represents growth, Christian growth, and then you have gold, which represents heaven, which we're all working towards. Can I hear an amen? And so that message is being spoken to those kids as they're doing this, and so they're hearing the plan of salvation. They're taking the plan home with them, and so it's a great opportunity for us to witness to each one that comes through that. I'll be sharing a couple of different things from the pulpit or from a platform out there three or four times during the evening. They'll be short because it's hard to keep people's attentions, but pray that God will help it to go well. I'm going to challenge them on a couple thoughts and a couple different things, and we'll do them a couple times each. But throughout the night, we want the people to know it's great to have fun, it's great to do all that, but the real thing is knowing Jesus. Amen? And so this is what it's all about, hoping that we will touch lives for the kingdom of God. So with all that being said, will you do this for me this week? Will you take a few moments every day this week and pray for our fall festival? Will you pray that God will touch the lives of everyone who comes across that driveway on Friday night? And as people drive by and they see the crowds that are coming through, that they will also be drawn in by the Spirit of God? Will you do that? Not that we can say we had this many people here, but that we can say, God, we're doing our best for you, and we're giving it our all so that we can touch lives for the kingdom of God. So how many of you will pray with me this week? At least once a day, you'll take a moment, and you'll pray a prayer and say, Lord, anoint every worker, equip every worker, let the people's lives be changed as they come on these grounds. Let them feel the presence of God when they come on, the peace of God that will surpass all their understandings. Amen? Amen. Take a minute and turn with me to the book of Revelations. You say, Pastor, that's Sunday night. No. I'm going back to get something for you. Some of you missed this one. And I knew I was going to preach this one a long time ago, but I've been waiting for this moment. And I'm so glad you're here. And how many of you are glad you're here this morning? Would you just turn to your neighbor and say, I'm glad you're here. Amen. Revelations chapter 3. If you'll look with me, Revelations chapter 3, and we're going to read starting beginning in verse 14 today. Revelations 3:14. I'm calling this message is entitled, I mentioned a few weeks ago, but I entitled this message, The Christless Church. The Christless Church. The church without Christ, basically. Listen as I read these first few verses. And we get into the word today. Father, I pray you would just bless this word today as we read it. God, I pray that you would give us ears to hear what the Spirit is saying. Lord, minister to each and every one that's here. Lord, for those of us that are struggling in our walk with you, God, I pray that we will become more faithful. And God, that you will accomplish in this next few moments what you so desire to do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Revelations 3:14 says, To the angel of the church at Laodicea write, These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need anything. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, naked. I counsel you to buy for me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Verse 21, to him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Amen. I like that verse that says in verse 19, to whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. How many of you know that your daddy or your mama, when you were a kid, used to come to you, and when they'd pull out the belt, they'd say, this is going to hurt me more than it hurts you? And you would say, I don't believe it. Because every time we get through with this routine, something hurts on the backside. How can it hurt you more than it's hurting me? You're holding the whip. You're holding the paddle. You're holding the belt. But it hurts Dad to have to do the correction. But Dad knows he has to correct, because it brings the proper discipline that's needed so that we can stay in line with what needs to be done. Our Heavenly Father brings discipline to our lives so that we can be corrected, so that we don't go astray, so that we don't fall away from the faith with Him. Amen? Amen? This morning, as we look at this passage of Scripture and we talk about the church at Laodicea, first of all, I want to say, what was the problem with the church at Laodicea? Think about it for just a minute. He said that they had become lukewarm. They were neither hot nor cold. They had lost their spiritual fire and their purpose. Think about that for just a minute. They had lost their spiritual fire and their purpose is what had happened. They had become complacent. They had become content. They were going through the motions of going to church. How many of you know it can happen? It can happen. It's Sunday morning. Get up, go to church, put on your clothes, get in church, worship the Lord, do your job, go home, watch football, do whatever you're going to do, take a nap, and go back to church Sunday night, and just do it again, and then go about your business on the week. It happens. We have a tendency to go through the motions. Isn't that true? And church becomes complacent. Church becomes routine. Church becomes mechanical. If we're not careful, church is no longer a true relationship with Jesus Christ. It's just another activity in our daily walk. It's just another thing that we do. You see, the church had become lukewarm. The other day I was in my office and I had, I guess it was Friday, and I came in. I was only going to spend a couple hours here. I had to finish a little bit on the sermon and a little bit for Sunday night and getting a couple things done. I figured maybe a couple hours I'd be here at the most. And finally, about 12:30, I was about ready to leave, and I started. I've been walking the property. If you happen to ride by, you see me and Diana and David, and you know, we've been walking trying to get our bodies back into shape. Hello. I mean, we are a shape, but we're trying to get a little better shape. And really, mine has to do with my blood sugar, trying to get it in line, and I'm really doing my best, and not so much whether I lose weight. I need to lose weight, and I'm working on it. I've lost quite a bit this last week, but thank God for that. But I have been working in the office, and I've made myself a cup of coffee. And do you ever get a cup of coffee, and you get it hot, and you're ready to drink it, and you take a couple sips, and you set it down, and you get busy, and all of a sudden you think, oh, there's my coffee, and you pick it up. And you just, it was cold. It wasn't cold, but it was just that lukewarm, tepid temperature. And it happened to me Friday. And I thought, I hate that when that happens. I know some people like iced coffee. And I guess iced coffee is okay if you put ice in it, frozen, okay. But I like my coffee hot. I enjoy it hot, And I probably could enjoy one frozen. But to have it just room temperature is not good. And it was, do you know what? That's nasty to me. But you know what's nasty to God? Is a church that becomes lukewarm. He said so in his word in this chapter. He said, if you're not hot nor cold, I will spew you out of my mouth. Just like I told you with the coffee. He said, I'm not going to have anything to do with it. If you're not going to have time for me, then I'm not going to have time for you. Hello. Amen. You see, to Jesus, there's nothing more unacceptable than a lukewarm church. Jesus would rather have us as a boiling hot church or a frozen church. You see, if the church was frozen, listen to this. If the church was cold, if it was frozen, then there would be no excuse for them to realize where they're at in their spiritual condition. They would understand what's going on. But the problem with being lukewarm is a church that's just kind of going through the motions and not spending any time with God. Really, they're just kind of doing their own little thing. He says, I'd rather you be hot for me or either be cold so that you would come to the realization that you have fallen away from me. You're no longer serving me with all your heart. You see, many churches today have fallen prey to the lukewarm condition. Many churches have come to a place where they have become just so-so. They're going through the motions. Although they might have a lot of activities going on in the church, most of them do. Most of them have become, though, guilty of just going through the motions. They have basically become a social gathering place. Let me say that again. The church has become a social gathering place. In today's society, we call it networking. Okay? We're going to church to network. We're connecting. The problem is simple. The church has lost its spiritual fire. The church has lost its relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Clarence Larkin wrote a book on Revelations. This is what they outlined, what I've been using for our study on Sunday nights. And he wrote this book in 1919. How many of you know that's almost 100 years ago? We're only 5 years away from the anniversary of that book. 100 years ago. Think about it. I'm going to share with you what he wrote almost 100 years ago. A little excerpt from his book. Clarence Larkin said in 1919, there are many churches in the world today. We're talking at the turn of the century. There are many churches in the world today like the church at Laodicea. More than any other period in church history. Many of these churches have cathedral-like buildings, stained glass windows, eloquent preachers, paid singers, large congregations. Some of them have large land interests and are well endowed, and yet they are poor. He says many of the members, if not the majority, are worldly, card-playing, dancing, and theater-going Christians. This is the turn of the century now. Come on. Y'all got your feet back a little bit? Come on. Get ready to stomp. Let me read that part one more time. Many of their members, if not the majority, are worldly, card-playing, dancing, theater-going Christians. That was his opinion of worldly. The poor and the saintly are not wanted in such churches because their presence is rebuked. He says, these churches do not see that they are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. He says, if we were to visit such churches, they would take in pride in showing us the building. They would praise the preaching and the singing. They would boast of the character of the congregations and the exclusiveness of their membership and the attractiveness of their services. But if we suggested a series of meetings for the deepening of our spiritual life or the conversion of the unsaved, they would say, oh no, we don't need or want such meetings. We have need of nothing. Let me back up and say, let me encourage you to come to prayer on Tuesday mornings. Let me encourage you to come to prayer on Sunday morning at 8:30. Come on. Let's have a special night of prayer. Oh, Pastor, we don't need that. We're all right. We are blind, we're poor and naked. Come on. We don't see our spiritual condition of where we are. Don't put your feet back out there just yet, church. Hold on. You see, Clarence Larkin said, the church at Laodicea was not burdened with debt, but it was burdened with wealth. What I just quoted to you was written in 1919. It sounded like it was wrote yesterday. I want you to listen to a pastor who preached a message just a few weeks ago. This is just a short little excerpt from T.D. Jakes I saw several weeks ago. Just a little clip. Play it, David.
The reason we are not seeing the miracles of the early church is because we don't do the prayer of the early church. You will never see the miracles of the early church as long as you live within your conveniences. There has to be a level of aggression. There has to be a level of aggression. It's not that God has lost his power, it's that the church has lost his focus. I said, it's not that God has lost his power, it is that the church has lost its focus. You can't hardly get people to come out to church unless you have a big name on stage. The early church was on their knees, and the only name there was Jesus.
Come on. Amen.
Can you imagine calling a prayer meeting at the Potter's house and nobody speaking? And the church is packed? You can't hardly get the church packed when somebody is speaking. Because the Christians today have not been taught for warfare. They have been trained for entertainment. And if they don't get entertainment, they don't have focus. Oh, God.
The church is looking for entertainment. Church, we've got to get serious with God. God has not lost his power. We've lost our focus. Say, Pastor, why are you preaching this message this morning? The church at Laodicea will continue to be the church of today. Everything that we read in the seven churches in Revelations chapters 2 and 3 were a foretelling of what would take place in the church of Jesus Christ from the moment it started until the day Jesus comes to take the church home to be with him in heaven. The church is going to get farther and farther and farther away from the things of God unless they wake up. There are churches today, and I'm talking about predominant old line churches. Look at our Episcopal churches. Look at our Catholic churches. These were mainline churches that started out. Today, they have removed all their desire to stay true to the Word of God. When you start allowing homosexuals to be ordained in the ministry, something's wrong. But what happened is we have changed our moral standards. We have allowed our standards to not line up with the Word of God. And church, I want you to say, I'm not telling you, I'm not trying to slam any church, but I'm saying it happens because we lose our focus. God forbid that Hilliard First Assembly should ever be a Christless church and only a social gathering place. I want Jesus in the middle of everything we do. Why do you think that I ask you to pray this week? God, help us in this fall festival to keep Jesus as a focal point. He's the reason for what we do. He's the reason for what we meet for. As we worship this morning and we sing songs, there's no power in hell that can stand against what Jesus can do. Come on, are you with me this morning? See, so what did Jesus tell the church in this chapter 3? What did he tell them that they needed to do? And this is my second point. What did Jesus instruct the church at Laodicea to do? First of all, we see that Jesus told them to buy his gold that had been tried by fire so that they could become rich. The problem was they were rich with their own wealth. They were rich in their own way. Folks, some of us have become so content with our salaries, with our increases and all that we have, that we have not been dependent upon God any longer. We're dependent on who signs the check at the end of the week. Come on. We're dependent upon who brings in the money. We don't need God to perform anymore. We don't need God to work the miracle. We've kind of been trusting everything else. Hello? We have found ourselves trusting no longer in God, but trusting in everything else. And everything else can be corrupted. Let me say again to you, buy gold from him. You see, they were using the wrong kind of gold there in the church at Laodicea. By using the gold that they were trusting in their own abilities, and it had become corrupted. Jesus told them that they needed to be rich toward him with a true and tested spiritual faith that could not be corrupted. Our trust needs to be in him and saying, God, I know that only I can make it with your help. I can only do it because of what you do. When I get down here in the mornings on Sunday mornings and I know I'm getting ready to come up to preach, I know that I'm scared. So why are you scared, Pastor? You've been doing this for 20-something years. Almost 30 years, because I know I'm responsible. Amen. And whatever I say better line up with God's word. Can I hear it? Amen. Amen. And as I get over here, I say, God, I can't do this without your help. I need your help this morning. God, I need your anointing this morning. God, I need you to speak into me and into my spirit. I've studied, I've prepared, but God, you take charge, you take control. Come on. You can do all you can do, and those of you that teach Sunday school know what I'm talking about. You get ready, but without the anointing of God is nothing. Come on. We need God's power. And the church at Laodicea was going through the motions. Church, if all I do is get up here and go through the motions, I've missed the mark. I don't want to go through the motions. I want to experience all of God that I can. Come on. I want him. The second thing that he told them, not only should they change their gold out for his gold that had been tried by the fire. How many of you know when gold's been put in the fire, it removes all the impurities? When gold gets put into the heat, it begins to smelt and all the impurities come off and they scrape them off so that it's pure gold. God is doing a work in us if we'll let Him and making us pure. He wants us to have that pure faith in Him and trusting Him. The second thing He said that we were to buy from Him, white clothes, so that we can wear them to cover up our shameful nakedness. Say, Pastor, I'm not naked. Neither were the people in Laodicea. People in Laodicea were not naked. Don't get the wrong idea. The city of Laodicea was a major textile industry outlet. They had all the latest fashions of their day. The latest blends. The latest textures. They had everything they wanted. But He said, wait a minute. You don't understand. I'm not talking about your clothing. He said, I'm looking at your spiritual side. Come on. Your spirit is naked. It's bare. It has nothing to it. He looked at this and He says, come on, you need some clothes to cover up that. Jesus said to them he would sell them clothing of purity, clothing of righteousness. Let me just say, you can't earn your righteousness. Come on. You can't earn your righteousness. It is only bought and paid for with the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen? And when you give up on the blood of Jesus Christ, your clothing comes off. And your nakedness is exposed. When the purity of your life becomes impure and you become corrupted by the worldliness of this world and things that take place in your life that supersede the love of Jesus Christ, then something is wrong. Come on. He said, it's time to put on the Lord Jesus Christ one more time. And then He says to them, thirdly, He says, then Jesus told them, buy some salve to put on their eyes, so that they could see. Not only did Laodicea have the finest textile outlets in the whole region, but they also had some of the greatest ointments and salves that were all created. They were a well-commerce city. They were a major trade port. If you would compare them to something like Jacksonville of today, commerce in and out, constantly going. People were producing. But Jesus said, the salve you're using is not going to clear your eyes. You see, your eyes are cloudy. You're not seeing the true spiritual life that you're living. And He says to them, you need to buy salve for me. And you need to put this salve that I have on you. You see, your true spiritual condition is in jeopardy. You are having problems. You have become tolerant and worldly, and you need to make some changes. God's salve brings clarity of sight that only comes from the yielding to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Come on. You see, the Holy Spirit brings clarity to our vision. I was reading a scripture this morning, and I was thinking about this. It's found in Peter, 2 Peter. And it says, as the morning dawn comes and we see that morning break, we begin to see the morning star and it begins to expose everything. When Jesus' light shines into our life, He exposes all the evil, all the wicked. But when our eyes are cloudy, we can't see clear. And He says, take this salve that I give you, the Holy Spirit, and let Him bring clarity to your eyes. So let me say this one more time. God's salve brings clarity of sight that only comes from yielding to the guidance of the Holy Spirit and holding firm to the Word of God. Church, we don't compare ourselves to the fellow down the street. We don't compare ourselves to the church down the street. Hello? Just because they're doing it doesn't mean it's good for us to do it. Amen? Just because somebody else thinks it's all right and it's godly, that's their decision. Our decision is found right here in God's Word. We do what God's Word says. Amen? The last thing that Jesus tells them is this. after they have bought the gold from him, they've changed their garments. And he says, and now put the salve on your eyes, helping, getting the help you need from the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. The last thing Jesus told them is this. He says, here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and eat with him and he with me, in Revelation 3:20. I mentioned this the other night when we were going through this chapter, but there are some of you that didn't hear this. But when I grew up as a young child in church, and even as a Royal Ranger, a little older, we learned the plan of salvation. We learned the Romans Road. We learned that Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. We learned that Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his love towards us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We also learned in Romans that all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And then we always went to this last scripture, and it was found in Revelation 3:20. It says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man open the door, I will come in and sup with him and he with me. We learned it as a salvation message. We learned Revelation 3:20 as Jesus wants to come into the heart of every believer. And that is a good analogy. It's a good story. But that's not what Jesus was really talking about here. And it works for salvation. But what was really happening was the church at Laodicea had become so worldly, they had become so mechanical, they had become so loose in their relationship with Jesus Christ, they didn't realize that Jesus had eased out of the church. He no longer was in the church. They had not missed his presence, even though they were still worshiping God. Even still, they were preaching God's word. Even still, there were people that were involved in all kinds of activities and ministries around the church. They had not missed the presence of God. And God had allowed Jesus to slip out of the church because they didn't need him in their services. They didn't depend on him anymore. They didn't say, Lord, I need your anointing before I go up and preach. Lord, I need your anointing before I teach my Sunday school. Lord, I need your anointing so that I can play the instrument, so that I can sing, so that I can do the ministry that I'm supposed to do. They had depended on their own abilities, and no longer had they become dependent upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus found himself on the outside of the church, and the people were going through the motions. And Jesus was standing on the outside of the church knocking, saying, if any man will hear my voice and open the door, I'll come in and sup with him, and he with me. Jesus had left the church. Jesus had walked outside because he was no longer called upon. They were so caught up in their worldly activities. They were so caught up in everything else in their life. They had no longer a relationship that was alive with Jesus Christ. Their relationship had become cold and different. Are you hearing me this morning? You see, the church had excluded Jesus Christ. They were known now as the Christless church. At one time, Jesus had been very active in the church. At one time, Jesus had been there, or there never would have been a church that started to begin with. He had to have been inside. But they continued to worship him and sing and do all that they could, singing praises, yet Jesus had withdrawn. Why? Because they had allowed themselves to turn to worldliness. Church, we've got to be aware of what happened to Laodicea. I'm not preaching at you this morning. I'm trying to get you to understand if we are not careful, we can become the very picture of what Revelation 3 is talking about. We must stay on our toes. Can I hear an amen? We must make sure that our relationship with Jesus is in hand with him. You see, the church began to seek after the things of the Lord. You see, The church began to seek after the things of the world, and they forgot to seek the Lord. Let me go back to what God had spoken through Jesus. It goes all the way back into the Old Testament, but Jesus said this when he was asked, what is the greatest commandment of all? Mark chapter 12 and verse 30 says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Church, I don't know about you, but when I read that, it means that I'm supposed to love him with everything I got. Amen? When we love him, we serve him. He's first. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What are we seeking after? I'm not talking about just so you can get. I'm talking about, what are you seeking after? What is your compassion? What is your passion? What is your heart's fire? What turns your crank? Is it Jesus or is it something else? Are you caught up in some other worldly event? You say, well, Pastor, it's not a bad thing. No, worldly doesn't mean it has to be bad. Hello. Worldly can be just another god. Come on. I said worldly can be just another god. Something that has taken the place of Jesus. That took your mind off of him. So that he is no longer in the first place in your life. So, number three, my point this morning is this. How do we get Jesus back into the church? We listen to what Jesus told in these other verses. We buy the gold, wear the white garment. You know, we put on the salve. But how do we get him back in the church? Does it require a unanimous vote from the church membership to say, okay, Jesus, we all agree, come on back in? It's not the way it's going to work. What's going to have to happen is each individual, each man, each woman, each boy, each girl is going to have to say, Jesus, I open the heart, my door to my heart, and I invite you to come back in and take over first place. I invite you to come back in. You see, that's how revival even starts in a church. It starts not with a group decision. It starts with an individual decision within each of our lives and saying, God, I want more of you. God, I want more of you in my church. You know, even if the pastor's not excited about you, then, God, I'm excited about you. And start a revival in this church. Lord, start it in me so that it will spread like wildfire. Come on. Amen. You know, it doesn't have to start with a big group. It can start in the back corner over here or in the back corner over there. And when people get excited about the things of God again, guess what? The fire begins to burn. Come on. Things begin to get hot and becomes combustible. And others begin to get consumed by the fire that God is wanting to do in our lives. Jesus said it so simple in 3:20, if any man hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in to him and I'll sup with him and he with me. The way to revive a lukewarm church is for each individual member to open the doors of their hearts and let Jesus back in. And then what happens? He says in verse 21 of that chapter, to him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me in my throne, just as I overcame and I sat down with my Father on his throne. I don't know about you, but my desire is to sit with my Father. My desire is to sit with my Lord and Savior. Come on. My desire is to be with him for all eternity. That's what drives me. That's what motivates me. My desire is to be with him. Amen. This world is not my home. Come on. Amen. This world is not my passion. This world is not the thing that I'm living for. Come on. I'm living for something eternal. I'm living for something that's going to last forever and ever and ever. This is temporary. Come on. I'm just passing through. I'm a pilgrim passing through and just a weary land right now. God's got something better in store. So I bring this to a close this morning. Let me ask, how many of you will help me keep this church from becoming lukewarm? How many of you will do your part in helping me to keep this church from becoming a lukewarm church that has a good facilities, and all we talk about is, oh, look at this, look at that. Church, I want to hear about salvations. I want to hear about people coming to know Jesus Christ. I want to hear about people growing and maturing and developing in the ways of the Lord. Come on. We want to build people for the kingdom of God. That's our desire in this church. That's my desire as a pastor. We need to be careful that we don't exclude Jesus from our services, from our activities, by allowing worldly passions to take the place of our seeking after Him. Jesus is standing at the door of our hearts this morning knocking. I'm asking you, are you going to let Him back in? Are you going to let Him have the first place in your life once again? Come on. Will you join me this morning at this altar? Will you come and just spend a few moments and open the door and say, Lord, I love You. God, I surrender. God, I give You everything. Let's make sure that this church doesn't exclude Jesus from our facilities, from our life. Will you stand to your feet all over this church? I'm going to invite you to come for the next few moments. You say, well, Pastor, I've not been bad. It doesn't have anything to do with being bad or good. It's having to do with keeping Jesus as the center of your life. It has to do with making Him Lord of everything one more time. And if you've been doing good, praise God, come down and make that commitment reassured this morning. So will you slip out of your seats? Will you come and find a place around the front, in the front row, down in the altars? If you come to come up here, I don't care. Just come. Come. Make a fresh commitment. We don't want to be a lukewarm church. We don't want to be a Christless church. We want to be a church that's on fire for God. We want to be a church that's hungry for the things of God. Lord, we love You this morning. God, we thank You for what You are doing in our lives and in our church. Lord, I thank You for the many blessings that You have given us. And Lord, we humble ourselves in Your presence this morning. In Jesus' name.